Now on BBC One Scotland, a pair of 80s Scottish pop icons are back with uncompromising views and strong language. Excess.
Please welcome from Scotland, the Proclaimers!
Michael Jordan!
Michael Jordan!
Michael Jordan!
Michael Jordan!
Michael J.
Hey.
Michael Ho!
Oh. Michael Jordan!
The best Proclaimers impersonation, I think, that's been done was Mike Myers. They did on Saturday Night Live, and it was so authentic that I actually had to check that it wasn't us. They got us really, really well. He got the kind of white makeup on and a kind of slightly spasticated movement. The key to a Proclaimers impression is that you've got to stand stock still, but move about. The singer without the guitar has always got to be better looking than the singer with the guitar and have a better voice.
Into the ocean. The way you felt the day you sailed from Westmeras to Nova Scotia.
I think there have been several bad impersonations, but we've enjoyed them all. I'm not going to tell you who they are. They know who they are. Harry Hill was great. He did so many pop songs on the show, and I thought, come on, do a Proclaimers one, do a Proclaimers. And he finally did it. He did it with the wee Japanese guy, and that was fantastic.
When you go, please send back a letter from America. Take a new off the rail track from Miami to Canada.
We're sitting there and we're saying, well, everybody's forgotten who we are, and then we come along and somebody does an impersonation and the audience reacts to it, so it means that the audience hasn't completely forgotten, so that's encouraging as well.
You're also thinking, that'll be £20, please.
Craig and Charlie, the twin kings of Uncool. Two of Scotland's few pop icons of the late 20th century are making a comeback after nearly 7 years of self-imposed exile. In characteristically rock and roll fashion, the legendary duo are making a journey to the Market Bar in Inverness. There, they'll showcase songs from their new album, Persevere, in front of the fans who witnessed the birth of the phenomenon known simply as the Proclaimers.
I've been so sad since you said my accent was bad. He's worn a frown, this Caledonian clown.
The Tube was a good show because they did different kinds of music and they didn't necessarily always go for top 40. And they brought new acts, like us.
If I'm landing on my balls, I'm putting it away.
It was a big thing to be going on it. Was it just Paulie Yates on that day or something else? But Paulie Yates introduced us anyway, and she went something like, here's something really weird.
And now for something totally weird and unusual.
This is two Scottish brothers who sing a Scottish accent.
Identical twins singing.
And then we met her years later, and I said to you were the first person to ever introduce us on TV. And she says, was I? I don't remember that. She did not remember it at all.
What can I do?
It's just two guys making the most almighty racket you've ever heard. And this was just like a revelation. You know, previously you associated two guys in a guitar with beardies like the Corries or something that your mum was into. And so perhaps your initial reaction would be to go, oof, not for me, mate. But actually, you know, this was the most exciting rock and roll, soulful thing you could go to in those days. Forget anything about Celtic blues or Fergus sings the blues even. This is where it was. What was really going on in Scottish music at that time.
They were doing something that was profoundly and sometimes quite crudely Scottish. And I think that in lots of ways they were a cold shower. They were something that kind of really woke me up to the fact that in lots of ways too many Scottish pop musicians had spent time disguising themselves as Americans.
Ricky Ross, Dundonian Glaswegian that he is, for some reason sings like he comes from Memphis, or just outside of Memphis, the rubbishy part of Memphis probably.
And the paperback rooms, and it's scattered on the photographs of summers and suns.
The only act that I could say we definitely identified with that time was Texas Midnight Runners, and that we'd always liked the band, and they'd come out about 1980 in Britain, and we went and saw the first tour, didn't really know anything about them, and got a bus to St Andrews to watch them at the university there. And I'd never seen anything like it maybe before or since.
Come on, baby. Oh, I swear, baby.
Kevin Rowland deliberately kind of stood apart from what else was going on.
The 80s, the mid-80s, was a pretty shit time, I think, for music. Pretty awful time for music. They embarrassed everything that was around, really. because it was synthetic, a lot of it.
But I mean, compare them to Bross, if you like, the super Aryan pop duo, who, I mean, kind of make Westlife look like, I don't know, what do they make them look like? Tchaikovsky, Shostakovich, and then Wham. Southerners with their trousers halfway up their legs, singing about how great it was to be unemployed.
Hello, we're the Proclaimers. We're proud to say we make the House Martins look fashionable.
The 80s is a fashion decade, I think, passes by, as most other decades have as well. I think you would have to say some of it's aged better than others. I think early Dexys with the kind of Steve Dorr gear with the hats and that looked quite good. But when you got later on into the more flowery ones with the sleeves up and, you know, the kind of girly haircuts and everything, it did get a little bit, but it got a lot undesirable. I would blame principally Duran Duran. That's fine. But absolutely. Then again, I blame them for the First World War. When we'd been signed to a record company, a couple of times he tried to. They tried to do the odd thing, but they didn't really try too hard because they gave up, man. They knew they couldn't do it. You know, you're looking at guys like us who were never in a million years going to be able to be styled into something that would be sellable.
But it's like they haven't changed their wardrobes since they left school. Well, they don't wear school ties anymore, right? And they wear long trousers, obviously. But that's basically it. And I kind of like that. It's kind of like you get a lot of these bands, and they, you know, like Posh Spice. She wants to go indie. And she gets to the designer, to design her an indie thing. She gets it all wrong, tattoos and tassels and whatever. But she just look at the Proclaimers. That is how real, real indie. When I say indie, I mean independent of any fashion, any style.
One, two, three.
Kilburn National, I saw them, and the way they would sing, you know, when you go, will you send back? They were singing in their broad Scottish accents. And when people saw that, you know, this sort of 80s audience, they just sort of laughed. A lot of them were laughing. People around me were laughing. I was watching their reaction. They were going, oh, woo, and they started imitating it. And I think people were probably sort of embarrassed by it, you know. And I think people are by things that are truthful.
Craig and Charlie persevered and found a crowd who could see beyond the odd fashion era.
I vividly remember going to see them in very early days at the Dominion Theatre in Tottenham Court Road. The place was absolutely ram-jam. Packed, packed, packed. Almost everyone, thousands of people, and almost everyone in there were Scots or, you know, boyfriends, girlfriends of Scots or whatever. And they all knew every word to every song across the first album. It was just like, we're Scots and we're in London and this is our band.
I mean, it is very Scottish what they do, but it's not Shortbread and Claymores and Edinburgh Castle and all that, nor was it the awful jock rock phenomenon. I mean, one of the sad things about Scotland is that, a bit like Manchester, it produces endless crap bands.
I think what they broke with was the idea, really, that Scottish music was, in some respects, part of the kind of mainstream of pop confection. And I think they broke categorically with that, and they created the idea that there was another Scotland, another set of traditions within Scottish music, which was much more acoustic, much more based on the authentic traditions going back through country and folk music, and perhaps the rural and kind of white trash traditions of Scottish culture.
Now I've got a question, baby. What makes you cry? 'Cause I haven't,
you know, there's a song on the last album called What Makes You Cry, which I think is just brilliant. It's just an absolutely brilliant song. I think it's as good as anything anybody's done, you know. It's just such a great song. It's funny to begin with, you know, he's talking about his wife or his girlfriend going, and she's gone, and he doesn't understand why. And he goes, I thought you liked football. You didn't mind those videos like that, which is really good. And then he goes, darling, admit it, darling, admit it. Your love for me didn't die, it's just sleeping, and it wakes every night to the sound of your weeping. It's just great.
The boys' highly polished later tunes do have unlikely roots, however.
First punk band we were in was called...
The Heavy Hasslers.
It was called The Heavy Hasslers, which I still think is pretty good. Pretty good name. Punk came along when we were 14, so the end of 76, and then really exploded in Scotland and Fife, and I think most places in Britain really exploded in 1977, when we were 15, and that was like a godsend to us, because it was people who were playing, some of whom were actually worse players than we were. That is really saying something.
When I wake up in the morning, tell me, baby, what do you see? I see my true love, and she walks up and she kisses me. I say, go, baby, that's really free. I go walking.
The television performance that stood out for me most was John Ottaway and Wild Willie Barrett on Top of the Pops. I mean, these guys, I suppose, were perceived as new wave, but they were like two old hippies. And it was so chaotic, the performance was so chaotic. I remember my dad sitting there, and he could get most of it, but when he came on, it was just like, this is crap. What is this? It's terrible. Half the time, I listen now back to the stuff in 76 and 77, and it's all the stuff that I hated. I think that's a great record. That's really that stuff that I thought was good. That's fucking shit.
Yeah. But the Twins' true rock and roll god resides somewhere west of the shambolic punk ethos.
Jerry Lee is the best. Jerry Lee.
If you can take Johnny Rotten, you can take Mick Jagger,
the best.
Liam Gallagher, and everybody else that's ever come. Try to take the crown, you could put them into a bucket, crunch them all up, and try to distill it, and they would come nowhere near. This guy is so near satanic that it makes Mick Jagger look like Andy Paddy.
Here's one you won't forget. Nobody else. Come on over, baby. Hold out a shake it going on.
Come on over, baby. Baby, you can't go wrong. We're faking whole lot of shaking going on.
Come on, little baby, we got chicken in the barn.
There's an arrogance, and there's the pure badness about pure, not a virtual evil about him. He isn't faking, and you know he's not faking. And the rest of them, they're all fakes. They're all fakes. Johnny Rotten's a fake. Liam Gallagher's a fake. Mick Jagger's a fake. They're all fake. They're good at it. They might be great, but they're fake.
Come on, man. I ain't faking. Pull out a shaking. Going on. Yeah.
He doesn't like who he is. He doesn't like it. Mick Jagger loves who he is. David Bowie loves who he is. Bono loves who he is, but Jerry Lee does not like who he is at all. And he knows he's good. He knows he's good, and that's what makes him arrogant. But he knows as well that he's very, very bad boy.
Shake it, mama, shake it. I ain't baking. Pull out a shake it.
So, 7 years after their last record, the Proclaimers are on the comeback trail to Inverness. What's taken so long?
Where have we been? We've been at home trying to write songs, not doing it very successfully. But a couple of sort of fairly difficult years, my dad got very ill. There's a long period where you don't really produce anything. Well, I couldn't produce anything lyrically that I thought was what we needed, you know? Getting tunes and we're getting ideas, but it took us a long time to assemble the songs we've got now. But I honestly think it's the best group of songs we've ever had. It was the same with the last album, you know, we had a bit of a layoff before that. And although it didn't do brilliantly well, we enjoyed everything that we did with it, you know, the touring and the promotion and everything. We never really felt we had a career in the first place. What we did was we wrote songs, somebody signed us, we had a hit album, we had another hit album, and then we had a long gap between the album subsequently. That album did okay, did a few hundred thousand copies around the world. For us, it's always a matter of
getting a good group of songs and going out and playing them live. And if we're doing that, then we're happy. The fact that we haven't done it often enough is frustrating.
Yeah, I'd love to have a new Proclaimers album out 3 years ago, but it's really up to them to decide when they've got enough songs they're happy and they're big enough and able enough to be their own judges of that. They don't need a support system to encourage them that this song might be worth recording or that song isn't. They themselves know what they want to record and they know if it's good enough. And I've learned to be patient.
The support system that did get the twins into a studio was provided by computer giant IBM, who bought the rights to one of the boys' tracks for a commercial.
It made life a lot easier for us because suddenly there was quite a large pot of money coming in that we hadn't planned for. Craig and Charlie decided to put that money to good use and they self-financed the recording of the album in Minneapolis.
Well, the record was made with Chris Kimsey, the producer, who'd worked with people as various as Rolling Stones and Deacon Blue, the Scottish band, you know, he'd worked with them.
We thought it was good to be there and be around that environment rather than to record it in Scotland or in London or anywhere in Europe, really. We wanted to have that flavour.
The thing for me was walking out the back door of the studio and there's a big river there. We'd been there for about 2 days and there was a big river. Walked out the back door of the studio and said to one of the guys that was working there, "What's that river?" He said, "That's the Mississippi." And I thought, ah, right, that's why it sounds like this. That's what it's got to do with.
Dirt on the boys. Well, let's see. The only dirt I can think of is I don't think Craig paid his phone bill. I think he managed to escape the hotel without paying it.
Are Craig and Charlie rock and roll animals? Rock and roll, yes. Animals, probably no. Very, very rock and roll, all the way down to the core. The most rock and roll people I've ever met. Rock and roll animals, no.
It comes out occasionally when AC/DC gets pumped up to volume 10 on the tour bus and they start leaping about the place, but you know, generally they don't abuse themselves on the road in terms of, you know, either look after their voices, they get a lot of sleep, and it is work.
They have had their moments. Can I tell you a story? Posh hotel on tour, one of the boys, who shall remain nameless, the night before the gig at the hotel bar got absolutely out of his face, and there was some sort of posh reception on, and loads of people walking around in ball gowns and stuff, and there was ice cubes and abuse and things being thrown about. And it got kind of out of order, people falling off bar stools, so eventually the bar staff asked this gentleman to leave. And then, same hotel next night after the show, same guy walks straight into the bar, right up to the bar, looks him straight in the eye and says, "I heard my brother was right out of order in here last night. What are you guys having?"
Pausing only for a picture with a local enthusiast, the rock and roll animals hit the road and launch into a tonsil tester for the evening's gig in Inverness.
Hold hands with a person to your right. Hold hands and try to look sincere. Tell them, oh, you don't know their name. That you still can't feel the pain. Yeah, you still can feel the pain. We'll sing Jerusalem now, boys.
Sing Jerusalem, Jerusalem.
As we build a land fit for zeros. It's all that I can do to stop big tears from welling up, big tears from welling up. If you thought this is your country, you can just forget it, forget it. You're too old, you're too poor, you're too posh, you'll never get in here wearing that, my dear.
It's not so much specifically a comment on Blair or the New Labour, much as I loathe them both. It's more a sort of comment, a general comment about Britain in general, and a kind of sort of wishy-washy, touchy-feely thing that's come over. It's not just the Labour Party, they're just the worst exponents of it. It's a sort of general sort of thing in Britain just now. We've never ever had any allegiance we've had, be it a football club or a political cause or whatever. We've never, if we've got something, we'll come out and say it. Instead of saying, "Oh, I'm not really interested in politics," when someone's got an agenda, they're shifting somewhere else, we don't do that. We'll say, well, if someone asks us a straight question, we're going to give them a straight answer.
and were not per se a political act.
Will you go? Will you send back a letter from America? Take a look at the rail track.
The political polemic that they had in Letter from America in particular was just staggering, the way they managed to talk about, you know, Linwood and Bathgate, and then link that back to the Highland clearances. Again, you weren't expecting that in a pop record.
In one of the verses, it talks almost as if it's an individual who's trying to plead with someone not to go, and it says, you know, I wanted to hug you, but we always wait too long. And in a way, that's the real true power of the Proclaimer songs, the ability to turn the personal into the political.
We don't smoke marijuana.
With their knack for combining the personal and the political, the twins share musical roots with one of their heroes, country legend Merle Haggard.
Merle Haggard is the epitome of Putin taking something that is political and is on the surface obviously political, but it comes from a personal root. The most famous Merle Haggard song, and the most misunderstood, is "Okie from Muskogee." We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee. We don't take our trips on LSD.
We still wave
all glory down at the courthouse. And white lightning's still the biggest thrill of all.
The boys' impeccable musical taste hasn't always been matched by their choice of TV appearances.
Well, we've done some fairly appalling TV shows. There's been a few that I've regretted doing. There was one that stood out. It's funnily enough, a BBC programme in Scotland. We did Letter from America sitting on a children's roundabout. There's few regrets I've had, but that was the only one. I wouldn't have minded doing almost any other song doing that, but I thought in the roundabout. With that particular song sitting on a roundabout, it lost some of its impact. I don't believe we've ever been subject to terrible press manipulation, bar one thing that I regretted at the time, and then I regretted it later for a different reason. We had photographs taken, we did an in-store appearance, and we'd guys come along and they were saying, "You stand here, don't you hear, hold the guitar up. Charlie, could you stand over there? Look, there's a bucket there, could you pretend you're being sick into it?" So I never thought, I went over, was feigning being sick into this bucket.
Anything for the press.
The next day they published it in the Daily Mirror and it was George Michael was written along the bucket. And I thought, oh, I've just been set up, I had nothing against the guy. So we phoned up the record company and sort of left a message, "Very sorry, it was a setup, we're new to the game." Subsequently, I really regret apologising, but, you know, I've had it all over now, I wouldn't apologise for anything. We did one of these Saturday morning TV shows, BBC One, Swap Shop or whatever it was called, and a little girl phoned up to ask where we had met. It's excusable for my child, but I swear to God, we have sat down with DJs and journalists. It has happened over the phone and actually sitting down right in front of you. You're sitting, there's a two there, and they will say, "So how long have you been together? Where did you meet?" Name them. That has happened. I'm not going to, because I can't remember who it was, but he was in Stoke, and I think his first name was Darren. We got asked to do a show called Eggs and Baker, which was filmed in Liverpool.
You dunk it in a desiccated coconut, and then you plop an apricot half on top.
What do you do?
I eat them. Sounds like my kind of production line. All right, ready? 3, 2, 1, go!
It was Cheryl Baker, who was in Bucks Fizz, very nice lady, and it was basically a kids programme, and it was pop music and cooking, so it was right for us. But I think it was like a Wednesday afternoon, we were filming it, but we had a gig that night in Stirling. The record company said, "You've got to do this." It wasn't a big programme, but you've got to do it. I said, "Well, we can't, we've got the gig." And they said, "Oh, okay, we'll fly you down." Fly down to Liverpool. And we went to the airport and they had given us a Learjet. I think we're making biscuits or something.
Right now, the Proclaimers are about as far away from the Learjets, Eurovision winners and apricot biscuits as they can possibly get. On the outskirts of Inverness, they're just a couple of hours away from a reunion with some of their oldest fans.
You think, what are these pair, you know, you look at them and think,
This is going to be crap, you know?
When you see two great big laddies like that looking the way that the Proclaimers did, it was very unusual in those days. Everybody was so very image conscious.
Well, I don't think you could call them cool or fashionable, but very down to earth.
It was deliberately not fashionable.
Yeah. I mean, the thing I remember most is everyone singing along to every song. Yeah. You know, you actually couldn't hear them half the time because everyone was pretending they were from Ochtermachty.
Is that the whole thing with the word and all that? But everybody spoke like that. Everybody were proud to be like from where they were from. But it was just like the Proclaimers were doing that for Scotland.
I think we played it back at Bath, 4 or 5 times, something like that. It was upstairs. And we went in, and as you know, see tonight, is a very small place. And when we played, there was no PA whatsoever. It was just me and Charlie and the guitar. So you try to get up a wee bit higher than the audience in the corner and just sing as loud as you can. The Market Bar is definitely where it all started.
Access returns to BBC One Scotland next Tuesday evening with a programme about the impact of the curry on Scottish culture. The full Buna, next Tuesday at 10:45. BBC One Scotland.
There's three of them. There's a spare one, there's another brother, Wally, and he stays in the bus and they just rotate the gigs. Triplets.